Mark, thank you so much for taking the time and meeting with me today.
Mike, it's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. So we'll get right into it. Mark, you've long been a strong advocate of sustainable business practices. As long ago as 2014, you and Pope Francis talked about how people and their well-being need to be at the center of our economic and political life. Your new book, Values, Building a Better World for All, eloquently makes the case that individuals, businesses, and governments need to make different choices. Yet, when we look at the world today, the economic, environmental, and societal pictures is not a positive one. That was again driven home in the UN report by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. How did we get here?
Well, there's a number of things got us in this position, which is part of the reason why I wrote the book and part of the reason for the focus on sustainable business practices and sustainable disclosure around those business practices, something I suspect we'll get into. You know, there are a few challenges. I'm a huge fan of the market, but there are a few challenges of having too much emphasis and sole emphasis on the market. The first are classic ones, which are market imperfections like monopolies or externalities in the environment, so you know, need to be addressed. The second is our human nature. We're all, myself included, irrationally impatient. Recent events take on a greater importance, perhaps, than they should. And that leads to things like the tragedy of the horizons. And the third one, which is the most fundamental, is that not everything can be priced. But our nature is, and we've set up a number of systems that optimize only that which is priced. So if something is not priced, it's left out of the equation. The environment is an example. Aspects of community and other aspects of sustainability are other examples. So there's a need to rebalance between value in the market and values of society. And it can be done. And there's a number of steps that I try to outline in the book that accomplish that.
Now, in your most recent book, you talk about the multiple factors needed to drive positive change. You note the need to build resilience, capacity, and manage ongoing change by moving to a just-in-case versus a just-in-time thinking. What critical levers do we need as catalysts to change the tide?
Well, you know, I mean, one of my experiences, and we're all, you know, prisoners of our past, but one of my experiences when I was governor of the Bank of Canada was, of course, the financial crisis. And I benefited, and the country, more importantly, benefited from people like David Dodge and his colleagues who thought about what might happen in advance and who prepared for the worst scenarios. There were some great leaders in the private sector. Ed Clark at TD Bank would be another example. And it's that discipline of thinking, not always reassuring yourself that the bad thing won't happen, but thinking about, well, what happens if it does, and then taking preparation in advance. Obviously, the pandemic worldwide, there were many and ample warnings about the likelihood, in fact, almost the certainty of what's happening. But no government really took the steps in advance. And the question is why, and you know that goes to your question. What structures can we put in place in order to take the necessary measures to build resilience in advance so it's there when it's needed? Now, I wouldn't say we've absolutely solved it, but we've taken huge steps in the financial sector. We have specific institutions, the Bank of Canada, for example, who are responsible for identifying these risks. We have structures between the federal agencies and the provincial agencies that then need to act to address those risks, and there's an accountability to that. We need the same thing on the health side. We need the same thing on the environmental side. And so we need to build these structures, and I know this sounds a little dreary, but to plan for failure, assume failure. What would we wish we had done when that failure happens? If we do it in advance, then we have that resilience and we can ride through it.
You talk about failure there and the importance to make change sooner rather than later. How much time do we have?
Well, if we're talking about climate, we have very little time. And you just referenced, Mike, the IPCC report, which effectively one of the most striking things in that report, apart from the documentation of the extreme events and the fact that the temperature is already 1.1 degrees above pre-industrial levels, is that to achieve the goals of the Paris Agreement, to stabilize the climate, at 1.5 degrees, at current rates of emissions, we have less than a decade we will exhaust our carbon budget within a decade. CPAs know how to calculate budgets. You can do these numbers. So we need to bend the curves quite substantially. We need to be reducing emissions by about 7% per annum, year in, year out, over the course of the next 10 years. And we need to start now. So we have very little time. The more optimistic, the more positive is that I think there's an increased recognition of this. There's an organizing principle getting to net zero, consistent with 1.5 degrees. And that's starting to not just be embedded at the country level with country objectives, but cascade down to businesses and, very importantly, the financial sector.
You've recently been heard saying that two of the crises are credit and COVID. So I'll focus a bit on COVID right now. There's no doubt that the global pandemic has prompted a reset for individuals, businesses, governments to rethink things. And it's given everyone the opportunity to kind of maybe step back and rethink what is important, which is giving new life to the concept of purpose-driven business. You believe that to create a sustainable recovery, we will need to favor regeneration over redistribution and ensure that we're rebuilding based on the concept of right values. Could you maybe talk more about how you see this working and the impact it can have?
Yeah, well, let's pick out a few of those points. One is around purpose-driven businesses. And just to be clear, in the end, businesses, whether it's you're providing a service in the tech industry or you're building a new product, ultimately you're solving a problem for people. You're providing a service, a good for people, and the question is what is that issue that you're solving? You know, one of the great Canadian companies, global companies, is Shopify, for example. And what are they doing? They're a platform for entrepreneurs. They're there for the entrepreneurs. They're there for businesses. And they get up every day and seemingly through the night, and they think about how to make that better. And the consequence of that is that their suppliers, their employees, and their businesses all work together as part of that ecosystem for the common goal of making commerce work better globally. So that's a sense of purpose, which is not elevated to a level of the sustainable development goals. Now, within... purpose as a unifying idea for a business, a mission for a business that then cascades down through the employees, through the suppliers, through the clients, and really makes the boundary of the firm more permeable, if you will. Everybody's working in the same direction. Tremendous value creation in all senses of the world, financial value creation as well, all senses of the word, financial value as well as social value in those regards. Now, one of the things that is shifting, though, in parallel with that, is a recognition of broader responsibilities of business. You're members of the community. We have these big societal issues. You're as strong as your society, ultimately. We need an inclusive society. We need a sustainable economy in all senses. And is your business aligned with that? Are your hiring practices consistent with that? Are you developing people in a way that's consistent with that? And ultimately, what's being asked, last point on business now, we're talking about the climate, is do you have a plan for net zero? You know, if Canada has a legislated objective for net zero, alongside another 130 countries, and you know, a Swedish teenager can figure out the carbon budget, and we have less than 10 years, and you have to get to net zero to stabilize it, and you're a company, and you have purpose, well, what's your plan? And all of those come together.
Oh, you just referenced Shopify and a great Canadian business making change. In your book, and you comment that Canada has the power to lead change, that we routinely transcend the limitations of our size to model values and policies for other countries. So I want to touch on that. Could you maybe provide some more examples of how Canada has been able to champion and innovate for positive change?
Well, I think there's a couple areas. And one of them, this is going to sound like an odd thing, but it goes to process. So I, as you know, worked in the with financial regulation of the Bank of Canada. But of course, the Bank of Canada doesn't have all the tools. There's other federal agencies, OSFI, that regulates the banks has and the insurance companies. But the provincial authorities, exceptionally important as well. CMHC, important as well. And it is a Canadian trait and a skill to bring parties together with a common purpose to try to solve common problems. Part of the challenge is identifying the problem. It's better to identify it in advance before the crisis. But we do that more often than not. And I think that's something that, you know, on any given day, it's more difficult for, you know, it'd be nice if power were in one position, you could just change things. But the process of coming to these decisions, that skill is a Canadian trait that I think we model, and I see it ported over to, for example, things that the European Union does, and it means that we're very effective where we can. Canadians can be very effective internationally when you have to bring together different parties, different viewpoints, find a consensus, find a synthesis. And, you know, in the area of sustainability that, you know, I know the CPA cares deeply about and is very knowledgeable, there's a lot of developing views around that. And so that Canadian trait of bringing them together to a decision is exceptionally important. Now, there's many policies and business practices as well, but I'd highlight that core skill because it is a core competence. And you and I know from as being Canadians that we have to, you know, you almost have to live it every day because you're constantly in situations where you are brokering across different parties.
This is great. You're almost teeing this up perfectly, so thank you.
I had that in the back of my mind.
So, you know, and I want to maybe step back into your comments on CPAs and Canadian values. And I'd like to talk about the Canadian values and Canada's role in shifting business practices to more sustainable practices. Obviously, we at CPA Canada, we share a common view that there is uniquely a Canadian approach to cultivating a healthy and thriving economy that benefits everyone in a society and sustains the environment. In fact, CPA Canada developed its purpose many years ago. We call it the Canadian ideal of good business. In your view, what can CPAs do to help champion sustainable business and social practices?
Well, I think, Mike, you started with the right point, which is that this has been the purpose, and it's been embedded, and you've been living this for years. So part of it's become bread in the bone. That's the first thing. The second is, I think when we think about sustainability more broadly, so environmental, social, governance factors, as you know, and as CPAs know, there's two ways to think about these in the broadest sense is, what are the factors that ultimately are going to have an impact on enterprise value of the firm? And it could be because of social license. It could be because of attracting employees. It could be because of externalities, public policy changes. It could be because of impacts on the broader ecosystem. But identifying those factors, tracking them, managing them, and, you know, it's down ultimately to the firm how they want to manage them and improve them, but having the discipline around those factors. And that is the core of it. The other aspect, which some look to, and there's different views around the world on this, is, well, what about the impact on, quote, sustainable value? So something that doesn't necessarily, in the near or medium term, directly affect the enterprise value of a firm, but where the firm has a material impact on some aspect of environmental social governance writ large. And so developing those techniques, those perspectives, informing the firm, informing broader stakeholders, or ensuring that they can be informed is I think, fundamental to what you do. And because CPA has had that sense of purpose and has developed that expertise, you're almost uniquely placed to be at the frontier of this thinking.
And I want to maybe just target that comment on sustainability and CPA. So yep. CPA Canada regularly convenes groups of stakeholders to discuss innovative ideas aimed at developing better business practices. Most recently, we successfully engaged a broad network of Canadian organizations that champion Canada's bid to host the International Sustainability Standards Board. if Canada is chosen as the host country, it's going to really accelerate the ability of Canadian organizations to push forward with sustainable policies and practices. How important is it for an organization like ours to help in generating a movement for positive change?
Well, let me say a couple of things. First, I can't emphasize enough how important the International Sustainability Standards Board is. This is absolutely a breakthrough for sustainability, and I would say for sustainable economic growth globally, endorsed by the G20 in July in the Venice Finance Ministers meeting. Doesn't that sound fantastic? In Venice Finance Ministers meeting. They have their first meeting. They managed to go to Venice. But anyways, they did some work and they supported this. We expect the launch of this at COP26, and it'll be one of the signature events at COP26 in November in Glasgow, an ability to develop the highest quality standard for sustainability that brings together all these disparate standards, which are all well-intentioned, and there's a lot of good in them. But as you know well, we need, you know, one core global standard. So the ISSB is incredibly important, and I absolutely commend CPA Canada for leading what is a very broad bid to support this that has broad support, not just from the preparers, but the financial industry, broad corporates and governments to support this incredibly important initiative. So you're doing the right thing. And you know, the core is, of course, is going to be not just creating this board, but living it. As you know and members will know, the first assignment of the board, or the objective of the board, is to come out with a disclosure standard, a draft disclosure standard for climate disclosure by the middle of next year. I mean, that's tomorrow in these terms, but that's a testament, one, to the urgency of the issue, secondly, to the ability to bring together all these different groups, and thirdly, to the quality of people who are going to be working on it.
Wonderful. Now I want to touch on maybe resilience, or on the topic of resilience. Mm. So Canada has established a solid platform from which to address long-term sustainability. Canadian values are aligned with emerging social considerations, and our governance is recognized and respected worldwide when you consider our strong capital markets and banking system. And I, of course, am speaking to the former governor of the Bank of Canada. What more must be done domestically to strengthen this country's resilience?
Well, I think one of the things we need to do, and this is being at the forefront, is that we need our core institutions need to have plans for net zero, which they are, to varying degrees, coming out with to their credit. Secondly, they need to be looking. We talked earlier about planning for failure. Now I'll talk about planning for success. So what's success in climate? Success is getting to net zero, to stabilizing the climate, getting to 1.5 degrees. But in that process, certain businesses that are competitive in a polluting or carbon-intensive world will not be competitive in a net zero world. And so the question for financial institutions is, how do you help those businesses decarbonize? Do you have a strategy for that? Or where could you lose? Because we can't have our institutions fail if society succeeds. So that sort of thinking and that forward planning is absolutely essential. We need to have that orientation towards net zero. And very importantly, what this means is getting capital, getting money to businesses that are going to decarbonize, invest and decarbonize. It's not about walking away from businesses, walking away from sectors, but it's moving them forward and investing. And we need to do that now with deliberation. And the other point I'd make, Mike, is that we have the advantage is that the country has now legislated the net zero target. We're setting up an independent body that will assess our progress against that in terms of the policies. We're seeing policies at the provincial level, at the federal level, that will help move things forward. All of our political parties are putting, you know, forward various policies. So we have a sense of where we're going to go, and getting the capital to where it needs to go is foremost.
Now, we talked earlier about Canada as a role model for the world, and then you just referenced the topic of fossil fuels. So, you know, I want to acknowledge, as I say, the elephant in the room. given our environmental and our economic dependence on fossil fuels. Can we in Canada truly be a role model for the world?
Well, I think we have to be for several reasons. One, and you know, I'll personalize it a bit. I mean, I grew up. I was born just north of the oil sands. I grew up in Edmonton, just south of the oil sands. My whole life, there's been a series of innovation. First to make the oil sands viable as business, and then consistently to grow it, and now very much a focus on reducing the carbon footprint, moving to net zero in terms of the operations of the oil sands themselves. So that expertise that we have in fossil fuels, but certainly in energy writ large, and that extends all the way to clean tech, we need to be at the forefront of these solutions. Now, we're only going to get there if we're very deliberate about it, if we're absolutely clear about our goal, our objective, which is net zero. It's going to require uniquely Canadian partnerships, federal, provincial, business, government, on a shared objective. And you know, the way I like to think about it is that we have these tremendous resources. We have, I'll speak in the language of CPAs, we have these cash flows that some go to the businesses, a lot goes to government. We should be reinvesting all of those cash flows in the energies of the future, including the transition of our core businesses and the building up of skills of people in those areas who work for those businesses. It's absolutely doable, but as you know, it will only happen. It won't happen haphazardly. It has to be done very deliberately with a clear objective and in a way that brings everyone along.
And you also talked about the importance of injecting capital to different sectors. So I want to talk about the another item on these sectors. How do we ensure that challenges faced by all sectors and regions are addressed?
Well, how do we ensure that? First is we recognize it. Secondly, we have a sense. I mean, we have two broad issues, I would say, and the world faces these issues. We a little more so on the energy side, but we've got the skills, the expertise, and we can be deliberate, as we just discussed about. But the other issue the world faces is, all aspects of the digital transformation, including very much the changing nature of work, which provides a tremendous opportunity bringing up various regions to the national level. Again, it will require very basic infrastructure, everyone always talks about it, but actual realized, broadband equality across the country. It requires education, it requires reinvestment of proceeds that come from industries that are currently competitive but are likely to be less competitive in the future. And it requires consistency between levels of government. But it's a huge, we have a huge opportunity in both respects, the sustainable revolution and the digital revolution.
How important is reporting to help transition the world to positive change?
It's fundamental. I mean, there is no in climate and broader sustainability, ESG, et cetera, there's no one solution, to be absolutely clear. But there are various elements that are absolutely essential. We cannot get to net zero without proper climate reporting. Full stop. It is just too complex. It involves every company in every sector, every region of the world. We need that information. We need to know who's has a plan, who needs capital, who's lagging behind, and the system needs to work. And broader stakeholders need this information. So it is absolutely fundamental. I would say as well that the private sector innovation, including from CPA Canada, from your clients, has brought this a long way, and now it's time for the public sector, broadly speaking, to take the good work of the private sector, to standardize it through particularly the ISSB, and have a consistent and comprehensive approach to this reporting so we can move forward.
So in closing, I would like to give you the opportunity to invite Canada's 220,000 CPAs, more than 220,000 CPAs, to do one thing every day that will help shape a sustainable society for future generations. What would you like to ask them to do?
Wow, that's a great question. Well, I'll tell you what my reaction to that question is. The word that came into my head was humble, and so humble in the sense of, well, who am I to tell Canada's 200,000 plus CPAs what to do? But actually, that is part of what one should do, I think, every day, and I try to remind myself. In fact, I closed the book with a short chapter, for once, a short chapter on humility and its role for all of us as not just business people or policymakers, but as individuals. And it's an attitude that helps you actually move forward. You can combine humility and ambition. But it also is something that reminds us of our place in the broader system, not just your clients, but the broader system, and the fact that what we ultimately leave as a legacy is our values. What values did you live and demonstrate every day in your professional life as well as your personal life? Because that's what the young CPAs will draw upon. That's what they will learn, and that's what they will pass on. And so just trying to bring that to the fore every day, a reminder. And by the way, I've been reminded about four times, including this interview, to be humble. So it's already so. But bringing that to the fore and recognizing that living these values has an impact not just on you, but very much on others.
Thank you, Mark. It's been an honor to meet and interview you today.
It's been my pleasure, Mike.